All right. So my company was Black Hills. They were founded in 1941 in Rapid City, South Dakota. So before I get started, I'm going to talk about my investment thesis, the industry overview, business overview, and finally the valuation where it stands. So for my investment thesis, when I first initially started covering the company, the price was $57.60, whereas as of November 20th at close, it was at $61.90. So it just shows, like, even over a month, it's gained close to, if not over, a little over four, almost $5. And as you can see on the graph to the right, this is a 13-year growth that they've had in the company, where they were originally only in three states, but now they're up to eight states. And also including this, they've expanded by opening two wind turbine fields, which has cut down on like electricity and natural gas, and focused more in on a cleaner energy. Their 52-week high was actually right before COVID. And their 52-week low was right around March and April, right when everything shut down. And one of the important things to notice is their dividends, as that's a pretty hefty reason as to why investors do invest in utilities companies. Over the past 10 years, their dividend has increased all 10 of those years. Currently, their dividend per share is around 56 cents per share, and that's every quarter. So that's very beneficial as it'll help reinvest into the company. So the quote above in the middle of the page, that's from their mission statement, and it really just shows how they're dedicated on showing growth within their individuals they supply, within the communities that they're in, and with that they hope to grow as a company as a whole. So as a utilities company, they provide services in electricity and natural gases, as well as very little in coal mining, but that's mostly for on-site generation. And so the company actually produces 60% of their revenue from natural gas, which isn't necessarily the cleanest form of energy, but it's better than coal, and it is also not producing as much as it generally used to. They're slowing that down there in hopes to produce more energy from wind turbines, as they have opened to in the past few years. All right, so a little company overview. As you can see in the map, where their two wind fields are, their first one was actually in southern Colorado. That's in the bottom left part of the map. They're broken down into two main segments, which is their retail and their wholesale. Retail is their natural gas and electricity, and it makes up roughly 98% of their revenue for a year. Whereas their wholesale only generates about 2%, and that's mainly from their coal mining, as they only do have a one mine, coal mine, so it's not like they're heavily invested into it, which is for the better, since more and more health officials have trying to push away from coal, as it does have many harsh side effects on not only people but also the environment. So they're trying to slow the slow climate change and the natural gases or emissions that are produced from burning coal. And so as a recommendation, obviously it's a buy. And so the target price is $71.50. That's actually from Bloomberg analysts. My valuation, I came up around, it should be worth around $78, a little lower at like 77.70. However, as Catalyst, they do have strong EPS growth, as it rose 75% from quarter two to quarter three in 2020. This also came with a decline in their revenue between these quarters. Additionally, they did just sign a power plant purchase agreement with one of their subsidiaries, Cheyenne Light Fuel and Power. So they agreed to purchase a power plant, and that won't take into effect until January 1st of 2022. But this power plant will allow them to produce a reliable, low-cost source of electricity, which should bring down their cost of revenue considerably with this contract. And for risks, obviously, there's environmental risks, as more federal agencies are trying to crack down a little on utilities companies for climate change and emission rates, just because they can produce a lot of emissions, which is creating and helping to advance climate change. And then there's also unfavorable federal and state regulatory standards, which are almost being updated every year and can really hurt other utilities companies. However, Black Hills has seemed to be able to roll with the punches and not really face any major shutdowns for this, which is pretty credible, since the regulatory usually comes out every year or 2 years just to keep up with new emission rates and different environmental outputs. And so, as an industry overview, as you can see to the graph on the left, in 2019, this was actually the first year where alternative energy sources were used more than coal was. While only be by a fraction of a percent, this is a huge step for the United States as a whole, since the last time this happened was around 1850. So for the United States to start using more alternative sources rather than coal for the first time in a while, it shows there is more growth in the alternative sources. And additionally, like, many hedge funds are starting to add more utilities companies just due to growth and their research and development into new alternative sources, such as wind and solar power. And this is also huge because many, like, Midwest coal companies are starting to invest more into research and development to look into new alternative and renewable energy sources, so that when the potential time comes when coal is almost get rid of, or the government tries to abolish it almost, they do have another source of energy ready there to supply their consumers with. And so for their peer group analysis, all the graphs, they aren't the leading growth in their peer. However, they're usually in the top, in the second, but this is because the leading competitor in this group is much larger and is larger by a roughly $5.5 billion market cap. So they're a much larger company than Black Hills. And with this, they tend to see more success with companies their own size. And they also have a 5-year total shareholder return of 73%. And compared to the S&P, they're only 1% down. And their peers are up, as well as the rest of the S&P 500 utility companies. They're leading them as well. So this shows how well they're leading the peer group that they're in, as well as where these other companies are located as well. So for management, this is Lyndon R. Evans. He's the president and CEO. He's only been the president and CEO for a little over a year. However, he does have a background in engineering and has his JD from Northwestern University. He's one of the leaders in the company for growth, as he has a background in engineering, so he's able to help with research and development and know what's going on, unlike some presidents of utility companies who might not have that background and won't exactly know what their like research and development teams are talking about, whereas he's able to contribute and know like the actual terms that they're using and help promote ideas into how they can turn their thoughts into reality with new, safer energy measures. And this is Richard Kinsley, Senior VP and CFO. He's been with the company for a while, and he got his background in accounting, so he's able to help with the planning committee and know what's in and out of reach for financially. So this allows him to participate in those conversations as well and lets the company know like what might not be in their reach right now just due to financial constraints, but over time, what they can do and what they can afford. So this is their revenue breakdown. Like I said before, 98% of their revenue comes from retail services and 2% comes from wholesale energy. They operate 100% in the U.S. in the United States, in 8 different states, and they see an average revenue growth of a little over 6% from 2014 to 2019. And as I've said before, you can look at the graph. Gas utility is primarily where they make their revenue. However, that is slowly starting to come down as they are getting more into natural gas they're getting more into wind turbines, as in 2019 they produced 7.8% of their electricity from wind alone. This comes from just their 2 turbine fields that they have. They also had very little litigation. So over the past 10 years, they've only had 10 lawsuits filed against them, compared to their competitor, Dominion Energy, who's had 485 over the same time period. And Black Hills Corporation, for their 10 lawsuits they've had, none of them they've had to pay out or they've necessarily lost. 3 have been due to personal injury, but those cases were dropped once they were brought to court. The other 7 were dismissed from court as well. So they haven't really had many faults in lawsuits, whereas these other larger companies could face upwards of 50 a year. So this really shows how they're trying to diminish that and stay out of the courtrooms as much as possible. And so their valuation, their undervaluation, they have had great EPS growth, as in 5 of their last 8 quarters, they've surpassed their estimates, and they've beat them by roughly 12%. This comes when their last quarter report, which was their 3rd quarter, they beat their expectation of 5.2 cents by their reported EPS of 5.8 cents, and this is from their net income also decreasing roughly 15.5%. And so some more graphs here shows their net income has skyrocketed over the past few years, as well as their expected free cash flow and revenue, as you can see in the bottom. They are expected to grow 7.18% through 2022 with their current projections. And they're also projected to maintain a gross profit margin of roughly 66% through 2022 as well. And so for their revenue here, they've had steady revenue growth, as I've said before, And from 2015 to 2019, they've seen 6% increase. But this primarily comes from 2016, where it grew 18%. And this is really from the new services they offered and new customers they gained with the new switch to their wind turbine in 2016. So this really allowed them to gain a much larger crowd just because more people are starting to be concerned with their energy and how reliable it is and how damaging it is to the environment as well. So they take that more into consideration. Thank you.
All right, so Christian, how do you see this fitting into Thunder Fund?
So I see this fitting into Thunder Fund right now because currently we only have one utilities company, NextEra, and they're up a little over 27%, and we bought them in April. So I really see the utilities industry growing as more and more companies do switch to potentially alternative and renewable sources of energy, as well as just more people getting back into work and more businesses requiring more energy to operate.
In what parts of the country do they operate in?
They operate in the northern Midwest, so around Colorado, South Dakota, Montana, up in that Black Hills region, as some people might know it as.
Okay. Does anyone have any questions?
Good job, Christian.
Thank you.
Oh, I was just going to say, is it like common for the industry to get a lot of lawsuits? Because just thinking about the Dominion lawsuits, how there was like 485 of them.
Yes and no. So Dominion, a lot of theirs came from like land usage. So they were like fighting over land, like whether it was theirs or whether it belonged to someone else. And like digging up land to put pipelines in. So it all depends on how big the company is and what they're risking, as well as knowing what's theirs and what's not theirs, as well as following federal and state guidelines for producing all that.
I had a question, Christian. How do you think the election results would impact this in your buy recommendation?
So personally, I think the election results are going to be in favor of this because President Trump said many times he was in favor of more coal production and more coal and oil, whereas what should be soon to be President Biden was more in favor of cleaner alternative sources. So this should really see a growth in like alternative energy sources. As well as Black Hills is only invested in coal mining very little. It only represents a little over 1% of their revenue. So it's not like they're gonna be taking a huge hit on that. They might see more regulation being passed for emission rates and how much they can produce a year, certain types of energy. But overall, I think it should be a benefit for the Black Hills at least, just because they are already operating in wind turbine fields and supplying thousands of customers off that.
Do you know if they're also going to go into like other green energies like solar? Because you said they're in wind, but
yeah, I'm not positive on that. I do know they just did install the wind turbines. I want to say 7 years ago, 8 years ago. So they're just slowly getting into it, and it did represent roughly 8% of the electricity they generated. So they're just trying to slowly perfect their wind turbines and capturing energy in order to expand that.